chemistry, chapter 19. I always skip some middle chapters. We usually finish in chapter 19 toward the end of the year. Usually I take the final after 12, but at the point where I game planned my lessons here to May 1st, the governor had not yet closed schools. So I was thinking I would do chapter 19 and then hope to do the final in person. But the final in person isn't going to happen, so I'll have to re-strategize on that. But we're in chapter 19. Chapter 19 is math light, vocabulary super heavy. It's a big like history, vocabulary kind of chapter. So before we even dig into that, I'm going to try to steer you away from one of my pet peeves. Even though I don't have to see you or hear you, it's good for you not to ever say the word nuclear, because there is no such word as the word nuclear. Some of our presidents have been not able to say this word, and I'm not sure how that is, but nuclear is not a word. Nuclear is a word. This whole chapter is based on the nucleus. We've talked about the nucleus in days past. That's where the protons and the neutrons are. Protons are positive, neutrons are neutral. Floating around the nucleus are the electrons, which are negative. But we're talking in this chapter about getting in here at the nucleus. So that is called nuclear, whatever. Nuclear bonds, nuclear chemistry, nuclear chapter. Nuclear is a word. Nuclear, not a word. There are no nuclear bonds. That is not a thing. There are nuclear bonds. So try not to say that. Weird.
Having our annual war games. Now, Simpson, because of your many years as a nuclear technician, we're putting you on a nuclear sub.
Nuclear. It's pronounced nuclear.
Oh, whatever.
Nuclear.
But based on the nucleus, nuclear stuff, here we go. We're in 19-1. So by now, I hope you read 19-1. You try to do some stuff with the quiz. But here's what this is about. Number one is Enrico Fermi. He did the first nuclear reaction. Other scientists they mentioned. Next time, these people will all appear. So as I'm saying this, maybe jot down some of these names. There's a guy who I've always pronounced it Röntgen, but he might be Röntgen, or he might be Röntgen. I don't really know, never met the man. But there's an R-O-E-N-T-G-E-N. What he was about was x-rays. He discovered x-rays. So if you've ever broken a bone or your dentist found you a cavity, you have him to thank for that. So Röntgen, x-rays. You didn't have to today say what they did, but next time you will. Becquerel is B-E-C-Q-U-E-R-E-L. He figured out uranium was radioactive. That was the guy who was keeping stuff in the drawer. If you remember that story, he was doing experiments in the sun. He thought the sun was causing things. He put his experiment away in a drawer with uranium, and the uranium kept doing its thing, and he realized the uranium itself was causing these changes. The Curies as a couple, C-U-R-I-E-S, husband and wife team, they won the Nobel Prize for discovering radium. So that's making the next paper up, as well as potentially this one. And then Marie Curie, as an individual, she won the Nobel Prize for finding polonium, which makes her an interesting bit of trivia. Marie was the first woman to win a Nobel Prize at all, and she's the only person at all that was a two-time winner. So she's quite noteworthy in the world of science. Nobel Prize is also worth another sort of pet peeve sort of thing. N-O-B-E-L, Nobel, true. N-O-B-L-E, not a thing. There is no Nobel Prize. There is a Nobel Prize. There are noble gases. There are nobles in kings and queens and courtyards. Noble is a word, but it's not what we're talking about for the prize. So Nobel Prize for them. Three was nuclear reaction. Next time you see a paper that's going to go backward, what is a nuclear reaction? It would change the composition of the nucleus. Four today was radioactivity. Tomorrow that'll go backward. What is radioactivity? It's the spontaneous emission accompanying a change in the nucleus. 5 is neutrons. That question stays the same. The neutrons are kind of like the Goldilocks story. It has to be just right. It can't be too hot or too cold. It has to be just right. So if you have an element that only had protons, the nucleus would get flying apart because the protons are all positive, like charges repel. That wouldn't go well. The neutrons are needed in there to kind of mediate that. If you get too many, that's a problem. If you get too few, that's a problem. And there's radioactivity where the nucleus basically sort of decomposes in a sense. You need the nucleus to have just the right amount of neutrons, but the neutrons are what cause things to be radioactive or not. Today's paper asked for one of the three types of rays that Rutherford found, and they were alpha, which this is the Greek letter for alpha. There is beta, so that's the Greek letter for beta. It's like a bee with a long rat tail. And there is gamma, which is like a fishy that's sort of upside down. Gamma rays would be most known to any of you that are into the world of science fiction and movies and things. For example, in the first Avengers movie, Loki's scepter that he carried was based on gamma radiation. And we had Bruce Banner was using, I think it was spectrographs or something, that they were trying to find all the ones they could. And he made up some kind of algorithm when they're in the big flying ship and trying to figure out where Loki's scepter was. But they called in Bruce Banner there because he was an expert on gamma rays, because you might also be familiar with it, is gamma rays indeed that turned him into the Hulk.
Now your field. How many spectrometers do you have access to?
How many are there?
Call every lab you know. Tell them to put the spectrometers on the roof and calibrate them for gamma rays. I'll rough out a tracking algorithm, basic cluster recognition. At least we could rule out a few places.
So the next time we take a quiz on that, it'll be looking for all three of the types, alpha, beta, gamma. It'll ask you for the Greek letter, which I just did. It'll ask you for penetrating power. No, first it'll do charge, sorry. So alpha is a positive charge. Beta is a negative charge. Gamma is neutral. It'll ask for the penetrating power. So on penetrating power, this is low. They said that paper could stop it. So that doesn't take too much. Here comes the radiation. I'm safe. Beta was medium. But they said something like foil could stop it.
Don't mind that. I'm protected because I made this hat from aluminum foil. Where I had this foil line.
For you. Gamma had a high penetrating power. They talked about you needed either lead or concrete to stop it. So like you go to the dentist, you get your x-rays. X-rays are kind of like in the gamma club. They're more in that zone. So they make you put on that big vest whenever they're doing your teeth x-rays, because they don't want to mess around with that. That's full of lead. That also hinders Superman from seeing things with his x-ray vision. It'll ask you next time for danger level. So danger level on this is high danger. Which isn't good to have high danger, but if paper could stop it, at least that offsets. This is sort of like a medium danger kind of thing, but those aren't too bad to stop. The gamma, fortunately, has a low overall danger level because it's tough to stop it. But gamma doesn't do damage as rapidly as the alpha and the beta do. And then it'll ask for one other fact for one of them. So what I want you to say for the alpha category is that ionizes gases, because you deal with this on a daily basis to some degree, at least in a protective mode. They talked about smoke detectors work on alpha particles. So ionizing gases means it can carry a charge. So what's going on with your smoke detector, wherever it may be in your house? There are alpha particles in there, probably. There are different types, but one type of smoke detector, they have these alpha particles that give a gas a charge, and as long as the charge is being conducted, the alarm doesn't go off. It's a happy alarm. But if there's smoke that gets in there that interrupts that flow through those alpha particles and the gas can't be charged and the current gets interrupted, the detector knows the current got interrupted and that's a problem and it starts squawking at you. But the alpha particles are the basis of a lot of smoke detectors. The book explained that. Seven today is natural radioactivity. That'll stay the same next time. Eight today is radiation sickness. That'll stay the same again for next time. So next time up, there's no math off of this. Again, this is a math light chapter. But when you read 19.2, there'll be 6 points worth of reading. And some of the 6 points worth of reading is like this again. This gets repeated even in the reading to produce some of those 6 points. And then compared to today's again, one stayed the same. Two became an 8-point question. Four scientists with a description. Röntgen, Becquerel, Curie's, Marie Curie specifically, what they were doing. Rewind the video if you didn't catch all that. Three went backward, four went backward, five stayed the same. Six became a massive 16-point question because we have one, two, three, four, five, that's maybe even more than that. Because we're going name, symbol, charge, danger level, or penetrating power, what could stop it, danger level. We're going for all of that, plus the fact of ionizing gases. So let me see. One for each category. One, two, three. Put this together, that's four, five. So it is a 16-point question. Name, symbol, penetrating, or charge, penetrating power, what could stop it, and danger level. So five facts per category, three categories is 15, the ionizing gases, that is a 16-point question. Seven and eight just stay the same. So again, it's a very vocabulary and history heavy chapter, but not so much math. So email me if you have any questions.